Thank you very much, Gregor. Well, I absolutely did expect a crammed, rammed, huge, full auditorium, so I'm still delighted to see that it is so, but I think it is testament to Helen that there are so many people here and so many people who wanted to come as well who weren't able to because it was sold out. So, you know, this is fantastic, but not altogether surprising because she was, and I still find it horrible to say this in the past tense, she was so special and so remarkable on so many levels. And as Gregor said, we're going to be having a talk about Helen up on the panel, but not for very long, because I think it's very important that there are so many people in the audience who wrote about Helen, who knew Helen, who bought Helen's work, who made her work in some cases, I mean, or taught by Helen. There's such a huge, great tide of memory and celebration of Helen sitting in front of me that I think, you know, we want to get your voices as soon as possible. And as Gregor also said, it is so poignant and perfect that we are here in the ICA, the site of Helen's great show of mutability. I mean, not only the rotting carcass, but also the beautifully elegant, decadent, fantastic oval court of Helen's photocopies of herself with dead animals, vegetables and minerals. Move over, YBA. She was doing it way before. And then, of course, you know, also she took part in many other shows. Bad Girls. She wasn't mad about the title, but she was pleased to be here. And most poignantly, we all came here to the ICA upstairs after her funeral in 1996 in St Martin the Fields. We came back to the ICA, sort of back to the mothership in a way, to celebrate her. So it is so perfect that we are all here. And I'm going to stop banging on now and introduce the first of the speakers. Marina is an early champion of Helen's. Marina, it'd be very nice to talk about, you know, your first encounter with Helen and what it was about Helen that really grabbed you from the outset and what is still so enduringly special about her now.
Yes, well, I'm really pleased that you and Cathy have decided to have this evening, and it's marvellous to be here. I first met Helen at Ego Geometra Sum, her installation of sculptures and photographs at the Riverside Gallery that no longer exists. And it was a very characteristic piece. I'm sure all of you know it from photographs, and I think it's been split up now by collections. I don't think it's together anymore. So it contains some of the seeds of her future brilliance, because it was already very transgressive. It's a little bit difficult for us now to see how bold she was, because she's been so influential that her language has become much more familiar to us. But this was a marriage of a kind of technology. So there were sort of platonic shapes that were pyramids and cubes and things. And she had devised a method of imprinting these with photographs of her naked body. Well, now I'm the oldest person probably in the room, and nakedness was off limits for feminists, especially beauty. Beauty was a really, really dangerous territory. So there were some like Carolee Schneemann who were working in this field, but it was very, very, very rare in England, and it was very bold. She was making a statement about the aesthetics of the female body as a language, and exploring it in an autobiographical fashion, and it was also witty and poignant, and this is something that she continued to operate on many different emotional levels. So, for example, she photographed herself as she was then in the incubator as a preemie as she had been. And in fact, it may even have contributed partly to her early death that she was such a premature baby. So there were these elements of a very laconic and very cryptic, but nevertheless very powerful autobiography. So I made friends with her, and actually we featured her, Gina Newson and I, who used to make films for Channel 4 about artists and such subjects. We featured her in a film we made, also with Susan Hiller, same film. And then she asked me to write about the Oval Court, which was a great privilege. And really, I simply tried to channel her. The ideas in the essay I wrote came from Helen. She was extraordinarily well-read and eloquent, a beautiful way of writing, of talking and writing too. And she had mined a whole enormous range, a sort of labyrinth of sources, from the Baroque churches of southern Germany to Netherlandish still life. And in every case, she was transvaluing these ideas. So her still lives are festive. There's no sense of mortality. Her love of the flux and debris of the human body is again celebratory in a kind of very exultant and transgressive way. So but I must just put in one thing about the rotting carcass. First of all, it was absolutely essential to the piece. And Helen had a very fine integrity about her art. She did not like people messing with it. She was a superb technician. And when the ICA, I'm afraid, took it down because it was one of those heat waves. Can you remember heat waves? There was a heat wave in London, and the stink was incredible. But she wanted that. She wanted the polar difference between the glorious gold and blue aesthetic of the Oval Court and this rotting mass of lamb and swan and
which
crab.
Which was a component part, wasn't it?
Which
was
all the things that she had photographed for the beautiful, festive celebration of beauty, sex, and passion. She wanted it all to be in the glass column, or she put it all in the glass column where it was rotting, but unfortunately it became a health hazard. But with what she minded was that she was not asked. It was just one day removed. So that was an example then of the kind of, I think, wouldn't happen now, actually.
Well, she has such exacting yes. technical yes. standards. We'll talk more about that. But I think what's interesting is, Cathy, you went to that exhibition as a student, or, you know, as a post-student, young artist. baby artist. And, you know, so you had this really quite Damaskine moment in that particular exhibition, didn't you?
I did indeed, and I was trying to sort of think about how to explain what the olden days were like. And I'm sure a lot of the people in this audience are from the olden days, 30 years ago. But there were hardly any exhibiting female artists. It's a strange thought now, but there really weren't. And in fact, Helen Chadwick was, I think, must have been 32 when she did the show at the ICA. It was almost probably one of the first shows of an artist who was a woman that I ever went to see. And I was thinking that the sort of, you know, that sort of pantechnicon of history that all the male artists who are working, also doing very interesting things at that time, would carry on their back as they walked to and from their studio and their exhibitions. You know, Helen Chadwick's weight of history as a female artist was you could put it in a pocket handkerchief. And I was thinking, oh, nobody here is going to know what one of these is. But luckily today, what did I find when I was looking for something? But this is a pocket handkerchief that Helen Chadwick made for the MoMART
commissioned
Christmas
by Eugene
commission in 1992. There's so many serendipitous moments of Helen's. I was very, 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 very privileged to do many shows with Helen in the 90s. In 1995, the year before she died, we were in many shows all over the world. And it was, again, learning from Helen that sense of no compromise with the work, absolutely no compromise, to sit there day after day in San Paolo, watching people trying to make the chocolate fountain work in extraordinary circumstances where the use of just putting a wire together was the way that they, by hand, you know, standing on a ladder, was the way that they made the wiring work for the chocolate fountain. It was just extraordinary to watch her day after day, show after show, you know, in that year, 1995, just standing up for her work, standing up for herself as an artist. She was never complaining about things, you know, just, oh, poor me, I'm the woman artist or whatever. It was always about the work. It was always about her standing up to make sure that her work was shown in the way she wanted it to be received. And I think, you know, I learned so much from her as an artist about just sort of getting on with it, you know, just actually just not, you know, just staying with it, being nice to people, being polite, being friendly, but at the end of the day, the work has to be right, you know, wherever it is. It doesn't matter if you're in San Paolo, you're in Sydney, you're in Rio, you're wherever you are, it doesn't matter. You have to stay with the work and make sure it looks as good there as it did anywhere else. I was very lucky also when I was doing these shows with her that because we were both working so much that year, travelling actually, we had a lot of significant conversations together actually, because every now and again, Helen was a bit like my own personal union convener. She'd always make sure that the artists sometimes would get a day off and, you know, that we were given a bit of space if we'd finished doing the show and, you know, sort of downtime, so to speak. And one day we were, probably one of the last days that I spent with her, actually, we were in some ambassadorial house in Buenos Aires. And it was an unoccupied house, actually, but we went through the door and there were all these feathers on the ground. And Helen, who knew so much about all kinds of things, she said, oh, no, this is kind of, you know, the local people don't like the ambassador, and this is, they've put the pigeon feathers out. And we sort of, it was the only time we've ever actually talked about being a woman artist, really. She sort of, in a way, we're just sitting, there's just two of us sitting there in this garden. And it's the only time that she ever said to me, oh, I was so happy, you know, when it wasn't just me doing these shows, when there were more women artists. She said, oh, you know, it often felt so lonely and so hard. And that's the only time that I ever heard her say that, you know, that actually it was such a struggle. Helen Chadwick, you know, if one could think of someone going through with a machete trying to make a path as an exhibiting female artist, which I kind of followed, people like Rachel Whiteread, you know, Connie Parker, you know, Mona Hatoum. There were lots of us that followed. Then lots of people who also looked at her work, male, female, whatever artist. And now, you know, I always think that, like, she was literally hacking through the undergrowth. And now a young woman leaving art school and at the same point that I was in, you know, 1986, seeing Helen show for the first time, they're walking along a superhighway with their arms out. They don't have to, you know, nothing's going to touch them. You know, the only thing that's going to stand in the way is their ability to express themselves and get on with it. And I feel so privileged that I knew her and that she was my friend for that year. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Cathy. That was very, very moving. And I think exactly what you say is that she was so influential. She taught so many people. And before I get the token male on the panel to say something, I feel we're rather extending International Women's Day, actually, on this panel, and jolly good thing, too. I just want to read out a little bit by another woman artist who sadly can't be here, who was taught by Helen, and it's Jane Simpson. Jane Simpson gave this rather wonderful, very short account of being taught by Helen. I was lucky enough to be taught by the art warrior, which ties in very closely with what you were saying, Cathy, by the art warrior that was Helen Chadwick at Chelsea School of Art, 85 to 88. She was a force to be reckoned. It was never a dull day around her. I remember her fondly, her workwear as sculpted tabards, and that small and perfectly formed battle cry of a brooch. I think it was a gold dagger. It was. Studying sculpture at Chelsea in the mid-80s, there was still quite a heavy metal hangover, but she was instrumental in encouraging us to push the boundaries of material. I was fascinated by cake, confectionery and surface and wanted to work with creating iced objects. Helen found me fiddling with small pots of icing sugar, took one look and marched me off to the gallery office and phoned Tate and Lyle. Before I knew it, a pallet of icing sugar arrived. Oh yes, that was her style, all right. A total inspiration. So, Gavin, you know, token male, but also Helen was, you know, loved every gender, every boundary was there to be permeable and all round. Viz piss flowers, which we're just looking at, being made as we speak.
And I actually did an exhibition in Vienna with the piss flowers as well.
Ah, well, far away.
Much later on. But I feel a little bit, you know, obviously I feel outgendered here, but which is obviously a good thing. But also I feel a little bit sort of slightly fraudulent because obviously, you know, Helen was just my tutor. So she was someone that was paid to come around the studios. She wasn't she wasn't a full-time tutor. She'd come round and I think she was supposed to be teaching the MA students. I don't really know, but she'd just kind of appear.
And you were doing your BA then?
I was doing my BA then. And if she sort of, if she liked what you were doing, she'd just come over and talk to you. Like, it really was. She just literally, like, dealt with it as as and how she wanted to. And she would always approach everything quite differently. I mean, there was at that time, I think, Gerard Wilson, who was running the BA department, was very kind of, everything was all suggestion. It was all kind of like, in a sense, And it was all about evoking. And then we had this woman, Rose McGreevy, who was absolutely fantastic, who would sit sort of like squat thrust and sort of and investigate everything as to whether it was a penis or not. That's a phallus. Like that. So basically we were sort of stuck between in a sense, and that's a phallus. So it was a very sort of 70s kind of education. But Helen would just come in and she literally kind of, she'd have a totally sort of different way of dealing with it. Somehow she had a certain sort of sensitivity, which was definitely modern. She definitely wasn't interested in the traditional ways of getting to the end result. She always wanted to try and she would explain herself incredibly well. She's very articulate, and she always wanted to try and sort of do things in such a way where. And I personally, at the time when I was at college, I used to find her work really difficult. I mean, it really wasn't work that I was used to. I think, you know, actually it did break.
In what way difficult? What time?
Well, I think it was because I still had sort of ideas of sort of, I think I was still thinking through ideas of sort of space and light or even quite kind of, I mean, dare I say it, quite sort of male ideas to do with intellectual kind of fiddling.
So the subjectivity of it was...
I think that, you know, again, I think that this idea of kind of the photocopies or the photographic work also, I felt kind of like it was awkward. It was photographs, but then they were sort of cut and shaped and curved. And it wasn't really what photographs were. We hadn't really seen this before. It was quite new. I mean, I do remember coming to see the Carcass exhibition exactly on the day when it was closed. Why was it closed? Well, because apparently the piece had exploded, actually. I think what actually happened was there was a tiny little crack and a little bit was oozing out of it. I know it did stink as well, but I think that then they tried to move it.
And then it all fell
when
over.
When they moved it, it fell over and the whole thing kind of exploded.
A deluge,
And gallons of this stuff, this gunge, went all over the floor. But it was quite weird as well, because I think she'd spent like the previous sort of every day for the previous sort of 2 weeks topping it up as it sort of as the level went down and it started bubbling.
With the contents of Beck Road dustbins, I think.
And I think I think it was all the rubbish from Beck Road was all being poured into this thing and it was sort of going down, kind of, settling or something. And so I'd arrived to come and see Helen's work, who hadn't at that point, I hadn't been taught by her at that point. And here it was, like, it was absolutely fantastic. Like, this thing just exploded and kind of had sort of taken out the top floor of the ICA, whatever it is like, which I thought was absolutely brilliant. I mean, this was something that, it had that air of experimentation. I mean, it was pushing and doing things which, you know, normally things were so sort of, somehow had become so sort of safe. And I think that... also for me, like I'd made this environment, this room, and we were talking about documentation. She was very interested in architecture, and she said, "Oh, what you need is my camera, because I've got this camera which has got a revolving lens, and it was the camera she used for the viral landscape work."
Right.
And she said, "Oh, come round to my house." So I ended up as a student going round to her house in Beck Road and borrowing her camera. So I think she sort of like, she jumped over the teacher-student hurdle, which was quite kind of disarming. And suddenly I was there in her studio, which was her house as well, borrowing her camera. And it somehow, like, for me, it really kind of pushed me, I think, on into that point where being an artist or being a teacher even wasn't... And I think somehow, like, she was... really like an artist first and a teacher, sort of just in passing. Mm. And I think that for me, I just, you know, I missed Helen's whole funeral thing because at the week before, a friend of mine, Joshua Constant, had died. And so I was so caught up in that that I missed the whole kind of, the whole process of Helen's passing. And so, but Helen sort of has always had a kind of really sort of quite a special... place in my heart, just in terms of like being a great artist, but also a great kind of, I think it's this thing, she was a great influence on me. I mean, I think she just really kind of, she made things different. You know, I think she had that effect of just having a different outlook.
I mean, I think absolutely that. And I think the other strand of this evening, apart from celebrating Helen and talking about why she was so special, is of course to talk about her legacy as well, and about how this influence, the fact she was so special, the fact she was so multifarious and drew in all these different strands, such a great transgressive original, how one then continues the relevance of that, and one continues and perpetuates Helen's legacy. And we were talking earlier, Frances, weren't we, about, you know, in a way the problem, I mean, it's a problem, it's more than a bloody problem, it's a tragedy, but, you know, when an artist gets struck down in the prime of their career with so much going on, but so much also in the background as well, how you continue to make that relevant, how you continue to place it institutionally within the context of the art world. And I'm just sort of wanting you to explore that a little bit about this legacy of Helen and how one can keep it fresh, relevant, both from a kind of institutional point of view and just around the kind of spectrum of the art world, really.
Well, maybe that's something we can discuss when we open up to questions. But I should also recall my own
fascination
with
Absolutely.
Helen, which was at the invitation of Maureen Paley, who was on the board of Arnolfini, where I was a baby curator many moons ago. And I think Maureen just thought that I would enjoy meeting Helen. So I ventured to Beck Road and, you know, mythical Beck Road. It was my first visit there. And there are lots of curators in this audience, and I wonder whether you share with me this this sort of love-hate relationship with studio visits. It's sort of like a blind date. You visit an artist in their studio. It's a very, very intimate environment because you're seeing their artwork as it's unfolding. It may not be finished. It's a very private space. And, you know, they're sort of the naked artist. And I have to say that my very first studio visit was, it taught me how to do a studio visit. And it did so because Helen was so extraordinary about welcoming people and explaining her work. And she had... I mean, I was so amazed at Helen's funeral that there were so many people there, because I sort of thought I was the only one. She spoke directly at me, very intimately, with this huge knowledge. And the only challenge I had and felt all the time was to not show my ignorance. Because she is, and I think, Marina, you pointed it out, she had this incredible erudition and the references to art history, mythology, to science, to culture, to literature were just extraordinary. And the unravelling of those when you see her work then and now, I think is the pleasure of the work, that it is extraordinarily erudite and yet absolutely accessible. So it's a very immediately... appealing and kind of repulsive, and yet really bears scrutiny. But then when I went to the Tate shortly after that visit, it was the year of Helen's project at the ICA, and I too saw that amazing piece here. And I remember being very, in a way, nonplussed about what category of work it fell into, because being an institutional curator by that time, everybody had their specialisms. And Tate at that time really had, you know, painting, sculpture, works on paper, including prints and drawings, but excluding photography. So where Helen's work fell in all that scenario was very confusing. And I remember being gobsmacked, literally gobsmacked, when I found that the V&A... in the person and through the person of Mark Hayworth Booth had bought the Oval Court. And they had bought it for the photography collection, and Mark had blown every penny of that year's acquisitions fund on the single work. And the idea that the work was kind of fitted into the category of photography and the V&A and its history was a really important moment for me in kind of unlocking the idea that transgression was a good thing, both in terms of a subject matter, as Marina talked about it in relation to the portrayal of the body and her own body, but actually in terms of media, and that there, she was a very early example of something that's quite common now, an artist who completely refused to be typecast in terms of their practice. So anything was up for grabs. And the only thing that united all her investigations into different media was that she was... everything had to be beautifully conceived and realised. So she was an incredible maker in all techniques. And I mean, she often didn't make the work, but the making of it, finishing
the
attention
of it to detail,
was incredibly important. And it was just a really lovely moment when we came into the auditorium today. And I think Helen, if she's watching from wherever she is, one of the assistants here was felt penning in the bits of raw wood
on
this.
The chipped corners of this table here.
And I just, that would have been Helen. She would have been up here.
With a black marker pen.
With a black marker pen. But that year, Helen was nominated for the Turner Prize, 87. And she was one of the first artists to be nominated alongside, Therese Alton, painter. And I was I had really been appointed at the Tate to do the Turner Prize because I had a some experience of exhibition making, and Helen was a really reluctant participant, and as part of her installation, she showed those beautiful mirrors from the Oval Court with tears, and the tears. It was a self-portrait. It seemed to sort of sum up her whole. The conflict she felt about being slightly shoehorned into the Turner Prize as a first woman, but also up against Patrick Caulfield, Richard Long, Richard Deacon, and, you know, male artists who in a way stood for everything that she had been reacting against since her years at Brighton Poly. And I remember her, you know, she articulated that awkwardness that she felt, and but she had tremendous respect for those artists. The Tate did not respond with alacrity to her work, and Louisa and I talked about this earlier. I still feel a sense of sort of institutional neglect. We could have done much more to represent her work. I think there was partly that confusion about where the work fitted in. There were very strong responses to the way she depicted the female body. But there's no real explanation for the fact that she was and remains very underrepresented as a really pioneering woman artist, or a very pioneering artist for all sorts of reasons during the 1980s. What's interesting, I suppose, from a personal point of view now is that I'm very interested in looking back and trying to explore some of the careers of artists who have perhaps been a little overlooked. And I think it's one of the great sadnesses of not having Helen is that we don't have Helen to help revisit this early work. And so the work before the Oval Court, the kind of work between being a student, and particularly
which
the
work we're looking at now,
which we're looking at now, this sort
oops,
of
piss,
this now. Work that kind of, again, transgressive because she worked outside gallery contexts and working with performance at that beginning, early years of Thatcher's Britain. It's so relevant to return to that work now. And yet it's so difficult to reinvent it or revive it without the artist to guide us.
And the technology too, I think, is interesting. We were talking about this earlier, weren't we, Marina? The fact that, you know, she worked, I mean, God knows what she'd do now. How amazing. What think about Helen with the way that technology's advanced. But the photocopies, the viral landscapes, we're using advanced technology, but of course now it's a strange kind of feeling that because things have progressed so far.
There's also the series of medical investigations where she did this amazing
natural selection
IVF treatments I think with the Welcome, wasn't it?
It was with King's. It was King's assisted fertility unit.
Yes.
So she actually got the fetuses in her mouth in a pipette.
Yes,
and then she created
and the ones that had been rejected. Some of you know this, I'm sure, but the fetuses because they're selected for implant into the egg, right? Yes, they're taken and Sorry, I'm not very good on how it happens. But,
we need help.
Anyway, sorry.
When
anyway,
you're
anyway.
They select. Yeah,
yes. Anyway, there are yeah. rejected. There are rejected fetuses.
They meet
and,
the sperm.
And, yes, and she created these jewels. These jewels. It was amongst her some of her later works.
But she was so brilliant, wasn't she, about the platonic shapes? And yes. There's actually no medical reason why the less perfectly formed eggs are any better or worse. Yes. Any better or worse at growing into babies if they're a bit wonky shaped. It's a bit like the wonky vegetables, you know, but
I think what's
just as nutritious. But it was that platonic, that platonic idea that everything has to be round and perfect. She opposed that.
Yes,
brilliantly.
Well, I think that, but I think it relates to something that runs through all her work, and it's something that Frances was saying about her erudition and how she picked up, she had the serendipity for finding certain themes. For example, she did an installation in Clerkenwell that was inspired by Leo Steinberg's talking about Jesus's symbolized penis with these great swags of loincloth that he wears on the crucifix. And Leo Steinberg wrote this extraordinarily sort of scandalous book in which he talks about Jesus's penis being present in all these images. But she took that and she didn't just imitate it. She created out of it the viral landscapes, the whole idea of something quite different about the body. So she took off, and I like to, there's a phrase that I think Chris Marker used, which is the lining of forgetting. And I think in some ways it's not quite the repressed, it's that what is forgotten has a lining, and she brought that out. She wanted to look at blood, she wanted to look at these discarded fetuses, she wanted to look at Jesus's cock, you know, she wanted to look at the things that are sort of in the lining of forgetting.
But directly too, I mean, layered with these amazing references, but not oblique at the same time. I mean, a cock was a cock, you know, somebody's bum was a bum, you know, a brain was a brain, and the meat was meat. It was always irrefutably that as well at the same time.
Yes, but also gesturing, moving towards a desire to shift the values so that we were being asked to look at look at bums and sort of the difficult parts, if you like, of the body in a way that gave them, restored them to some formal aesthetic that she was bringing forward that was still viscous and infirm, but it was it was an extraordinary aesthetic experiment, really extraordinary.
And the fact she could combine, I mean, I'm going back to the piss flowers again, which I think was such a remarkable piece of hers because of the hermaphrodite element, the inversion of the gender, the fact that they were what they were flowers made from piss in the snow, piss holes in the snow, you know, I mean, there were all these things, but also with these layer upon layer of interpretation and meaning, genuinely revolutionary works.
Do you want me to read the famous poem?
I think
just
you should.
Two verses. This is the wonderful poem that she wrote for piss flowers. Piss posy, drink me harder, my delight, swell to bursting, pretty sluice. Sorry, let me just get it closer. And piss a posy deeper, dear, here into my snow-white rain rogue about my pistol-shot hot juice, as if a bumblebee would lick my petals, pollinate me.
I think the fantastic rudeness of so much of what Helen is, but I'm sure that's also what alienated the chin-stroking element of the art world, you know, because, I mean, she...
because she was indeed a poet as well. I mean, you know...
She was a poet,
I mean, thinking of sort of, you know, that notion of, you know, a Renaissance man. She was a Renaissance woman. I mean, that, you know, she... Exactly because we couldn't say whether she was a photographer, a sculptor, or whatever. She was an artist. She was... an artist all over all of her art that she did. That was not a very good sentence, but it's just like she was an inventor of so many things. She was making art that in a way was talking about this sort of poetry of objects, if you like, in a way that one had not seen before. You know, I think that was as a young artist, that going to see that one could look at the sort of way that objects have a story and have a narrative and can then become a way of looking art, in fact, looking at art rather than making art, that was completely unique and new. And it's, you know, that notion of
we are used to looking at things like that now. Her work was one of the roots of that way of thinking and looking at work and making work, which is, to me, just an inventor. She's Renaissance. Lady.
But the use of subjectivity, too, I think is very interesting. I mean, the fact that it was Helen photocopying herself, using her own body at the time, as you said, Marina, it was so interesting you flagging up the fact that, you know, nudity was really a taboo at that point for women artists using their own, and their own bodies and their own beautiful bodies and relishing their own beautiful bodies in the way that Helen did. That notion of subjectivity now is so, you know, autobiography spools into our art practice to a great extent. Hers wasn't autobiographical in that respect, but using herself in that very rigorous way at the same time.
Didn't it allow her to have a, to sort of, using the body was an act, a provocative act, and she relished in the provocation. So there was, and I think actually that's what some people found so difficult, the sort of the exultant quality, which is very joyful. Mm. So there's this strange balance of being very, very blatant and obvious and the kind of repulsive and yet wonderfully so and very happily so.
And it, but also dealt with the voyeurism as well, because she seldom looked at the camera. She was always looking away or looking down. So there was always a sense that you were looking in a voyeuristic way. Mm. And I think that she really sort of forced the audience into a place where they were having to deal with their own discomfort, with their own, you know, with breaking through their own sense of what they thought they were looking at. And I think that's a kind of constant in her work, that generally when she uses her body, she's naked, but she's not looking at the camera. She's not taking part in it in a way. She's saying, you know, here's this thing, I'm laying myself bare, but for you or for, to in a way, to engage this subjectivity. And I think that the idea of the subjectivity set against the objectivity of the geometric forms and the Rococo and the, in a way, like the male architectural meters or sort of language that she sets up, that then she plays out her kind of, her installations inside. I think that had this really interesting tension. And that was sort of something that was, I use the word awkward, but I think I'm using that in a
but
sense.
I'm looking at Carcass
to make
here.
It lasting. I think because it makes it lasting.
And one thinks of Damien Hirst putting dismembered animals into these sharp, hard, geometric, minimalist
trees. I'm trying
trees.
To do this stuff you now. Know. I think this is what's happening now. I'm still doing this. I've only just got here now, you know.
But you know, well, it's so interesting.
This is my new work now. That's how I roll.
But one of the things also that's happening, I mean, alongside this of exploration or using herself, and is that she's actually making records of performances. So there, I mean, that she began as in performance. I mean, a lot of the early work, which would have to be in some way reconstructed or from, I don't know, archival material, is performance work. Extraordinarily amazing. Those domestic kind of.
And the rubber clothes.
Yes,
the domestic,
so she made herself,
and that she wore. Yes,
you can describe them better because you've seen the film, haven't you? Wasn't there a surviving film of that?
Of Helen performing
in the kitchen piece.
Of the kitchen pieces. Yes,
I haven't seen it.
But I mean. But again, very provocative. It was like, you want feminism? I'm going to give you feminism. I'm going to wear these white goods. I'm going to wear the kitchen. I'm going to wear the domesticity, you know. But I'm still going to show my tits as well. Yes. So there was this sort of idea of, you know, absolutely throwing down the gauntlet in that way, but doing it absolutely brilliantly as
well. Yeah, I mean, when she did actually give me one tutorial when I was a student at Goldsmiths. And, you know, she was very adamant that, you know, as a female artist, you just took the risks and just try not to be brave and to be tough, but, you know, just the important thing would be to try and, you know, to not, you know, think that things weren't, there was no permission, because of course there's permission because no one had done it before. You know, that sort of, you know, idea that you would experiment and probably annoy lots of people was part of
kind
how
of
she...
Kind of fine,
yeah, it was kind of fine, but, you know, there was that thing in her work that it wasn't really annoying, obviously, because we're all sitting here 30 years later talking. You know, there was something about it that took it beyond just shouting.
loudly.
Well, the rigour, you know, and the aesthetic and the intellectual underpinning and all these things as well, I think. You know, I mean, it wasn't just, you know, empty provocation. It came, as Marina so eloquently said, it came, you know, freighted with, and Frances too, with all these amazing references, you know, and the fact that she was so erudite, and but in such a playful way. I mean, I always found going out with her not remotely intimidating because it was so inspirational. I just felt like I could sit there like a sponge and be taught so much.
Very early on, there was that extraordinary icon she made of the Madonna with, what was the name of the person who posed? The singer. That's right, absolutely. Yes. Thank you. And that, where she had the umbilical cord and the placenta, and above the Holy Ghost was actually a close up of the vagina, looking like a little bird flying above the head of this Madonna. Is it in the slideshow?
I don't think it is.
And, but I think that it's so shaped like an icon. It has an apex, and it was definitely.
I think it was in the Turner Prize.
Definitely a gesture to a Byzantine icon, and I wanted to bring it in because I think we shouldn't forget that she's half Greek.
Yeah,
and I think it really mattered to her. I mean, there were quite a number of works that actually allude to. She's not at all religious, but allude to the kind of mysticism of Greek Byzantine faith. And there's a wonderfully moving piece she made with her mother naked, with her own head against her mother's breasts, and which was actually photographed on the roof of their house in Athens. And she did have a real sense of that Greek side. And I think, I mean, I don't want to be nationalistic about it or anything, but I think it gave her. A way into a certain kind of thinking about the relationship with nature, the relationship with the landscape. And there was a Greek thing in that.
And I remember she deliberately wore a cross around her neck for Ego Geometria Sum. I mean, she was naked, but she was wearing a cross around her neck. And I think she talked a lot about Greece. So I'm sure many people in the audience, you know, have also spent time, you know, talking to her and indeed visiting her house in Greece. You know, so I mean, that was a crucial part. Yeah. She always talked about her gold. I've got my Greek gold. I've got all my gold on. You know, with her rings, all her many rings. I think very much part of that. Yes. I think it will be a very good moment now. I think we've talked, there's so much to say about Helen, and it would be very nice now to have some members of the audience to talk about their thoughts about Helen or any kind of additions or commenting on what we've been saying or anything along those lines. So we've got a roving mic, and it would be lovely if somebody could put their hand up and start this off so that it's not just us. We can talk all evening about Helen, as you can see, but it would be nice to let some other people's points of view and other people's memories of Helen. Okay, the mic is going forth. Is the mic turned on? Oops.
No,
we don't need to shout because we might not be able to hear you.
It won't be recorded, I assume.
And also it's being recorded, which is important. Everybody has their voice in.
Hi. Oh. Yeah. Just, hi, Gavin. It's just an addition to...
a fellow male for you, Gavin.
He knows me.
Male solidarity.
No, just that point about, I think, Cathy, you said about, I won't go on too long, but about someone coming in earlier and with a black marker and about finishing off the stage. I was at Chelsea from 95 to 99 on the foundation course, 95 to 96, went into sculpture and was taught by Gavin, 98 to 99.
Blimey.
And just that kind of just that thing about sort of thoroughness and detail, attention to detail, that I went into Chelsea as a kid, aged 19, 20, and it really was the conversations, and I think this is about the legacy. I'm just commenting on the legacy, I think, of Helen, from Gavin being taught by her in the 80s to then the sculpture department run by the brilliant Gerard Wilson, Sheila Cluett, and people like Jane Simpson coming in, Kerry Stewart, Steve Johnson. I guess a lot of people in the audience might not know who I'm talking about, but I'm just talking about detail and attention to detail and the kind of, you know, the absolute examination of the artwork and the pursuit of success within the artwork before anything else, before it leaves a studio or markets or the commodification of things that I think, you know, under Gavin and other tutors I've just mentioned, that there was this sense of legacy that it was about the work and the work only and the bravery of the work and the and the encouragement of bravery through this teaching, which I'm realising now was, you know, Helen was obviously a huge, huge influence on that department. I guess it's me kind of recognising that and saying thank you indirectly. And I'm just talking about legacy, basically, and realising that. Just an absolute attention to detail within the work, which is first and foremost, which perhaps gets diluted a little bit these days, where, I don't know, I think that's...
There was that extraordinary time when she painted all the daisies, the centre of the daisies black. Was
Absolutely.
That at the Serpentine?
That was at the Serpentine. She got and students also yes. helping, maybe some people in the audience helped to paint the daisies.
Every single one.
No other artist going out into the park around the Serpentine and painting the centres of the daisies black. I mean, wow. And there was a whole subtext about there being some chemical within the daisy that was instrumental in possibly being able to help arrest the HIV virus. I mean, there was a whole kind of massive... I'm sorry, I'm being terribly imprecise here, and I'm sure somebody else will be able to correct me. But, yeah, it wasn't just making a sort of perverse mark on the daisies. There was a whole, again, with Helen, raft of cultural, scientific background. And, of course, Mary Quant daisies, the piss flowers were daisy-shaped.
Yes.
I mean, all these kind of references spooling through. Yes, that was great. And she made a great print, which, in fact, I've got on my kitchen wall, of the daisies with their centres. Anybody else? Yes, Sue.
Thanks. Is that working? Can you hear me?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. I can't believe, looking at this work, that it's so long ago, because I remember writing about this exhibition at the ICA, and I was a very baby critic then, and I'd never seen anything like it. And it stayed with me very strongly. But what's very interesting to me now, looking at it again, is that please, Cathy reminded us that she also was a poet as well, because I kept thinking of Kristeva's phrase about the abject, and two other phrases came into my mind about Yeats, the terrible beauty, and also Rilke, that beauty is nothing except terror. And the whole sense of looking at these again is how much actually they are sort of about death as well, that they're about the abject, about how this exploding piece, after all, this putrefaction of the flesh and things. And I don't think that came across to me so strongly as seeing it now. And also, Marina, you mentioned, the Greek thing. And towards the end, were they for your... Correct me if I'm wrong, when she worked with the fetuses, but she was making these monstrances.
She was making memorial jewellery from them, so she made monstrances and she made pendants and rings,
Exactly.
Yeah.
But in a previous life, when I was an jewellery antique dealer, those were memorabilia, those sort of... and mourning jewellery.
Yes.
And so the notion of death running through this seems
She spoke a lot. I mean, Marina's written a lot about the whole memento mori, the vanitas tradition. I mean, this was something that was absolutely crucial to, I think, so much of what she did.
That's exactly the point that I'm making, the memento mori, because of that. I mean, the mourning jewellery, the icon encapsulated very often in the 18th century, it was hair or it was whatever it was. And she was totally aware of that, I think. Mm. But I don't think even, now it just strikes me how much it is about the abject and the terribleness of beauty is.
But I think that was interesting, because I wrote an essay about unnatural selection, about the fetus pieces, and talked to Helen a lot about it. And I think what she also wanted to do was to make a kind of... Because these were fetuses that had they were not alive when she was manipulating them. They were stilled lives. The series was called Stilled Lives, and they were stilled lives. The couples in question had donated them, but they were not alive when she was manipulating them. But she felt a great tenderness, she said, towards them. She wasn't just manipulating them in a kind of way to, you know, mix science and art and play around with aesthetics and make remarks about platonic shapes and irregular forms and how we view things. It was also wanting actually tenderly to memorialise these stilled lives. So exactly what you're saying, Sue, was that she made these pieces of jewellery, the ring, the necklace, the pendant, to actually, in a way, kind of cherish these stilled lives.
The one with the swan when she's lying entwined round it.
Yeah,
this is incredibly intense.
I mean, I suppose, as an artist and as a female artist, I suppose at the time she was trying to look for other sort of histories to sort of create her language, if you like. So, in a way, you know, it wasn't just enough to be looking at Antony Caro or whatever. You know, she had to go further into history and mythology and other places in order to kind of create this language that she made. I mean. And I agree this point that 30 years later, one realises how important that show was, because I'm sure everyone in this room has some resonance in their mind who saw that show, you know, all that early work. You know, probably everybody in this room's got a slightly different image of what that work was, and it affected them very personally, and I think that is...
But it wasn't ironic thing. Either, you no. know, that amazing piece that I've completely forgotten about it, with the... The plait of the...
Loop, my loop, I think it was called, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right, and the hair. I mean, the intestines. It's such a powerful piece. But there's nothing ironic about it.
No, it was intestines and hair. But as you say, celebratory, not... I mean, no, I mean, Helen was never, never, never ironic, was she? I don't think there was never a sense... She was knowing, but not... There wasn't...
The early performance pieces are...
Well, I suppose that was later on, they were, yes, when she was riffing on... When she was riffing on the whole kind of feminist thing. But then after Of Mutability, I felt there wasn't irony in the sense of the body part, the use of the body. It was very kind of specific and direct,
but she wanted people to think that, to believe that she meant it. You know, it's like very an important thing. I was just remembering the thing I forgot to say that when the day we had this conversation by this pool, that it was the only time we really talked about witchcraft. That's why I mentioned the birds at the beginning. Sorry, it's just like, and we kind of had this funny conversation about whether we'd have both obviously either been burned at the stake or ducks, and whether, you know, a couple of hundred years ago, and we were kind of wondering which would be the best, you know,
best way.
And you know, that sort of, you know, that sort of sincerity of action, say like with the fetuses, I think that was a very, very important part of her practice, that her actions and her thoughts and what she was making was very, very sincere. And I'm not proposing in a witch-like way, but with that degree of conviction in terms of the particularity of her action, and that was very clear in her work, and I think people did respond to that in a very particular and very personal way.
But I mean, I think your point is, in a way, you're making a point about the reception, which can be kept a bit separate from what we were sort of trying to remember were her intentions. I mean, and what she set out to do. I mean, the last pieces that she made, which were not finished, were three monsters, I mean, her word, from the Hunterian Museum.
The Cyclops baby,
with one eye, a monkey that had been cut in half and shown as an exhibit, I think with a fetus inside.
Mm.
And a third one, which I hadn't even got there yet, I think. Siamese twins.
Yes.
So she was, and I found them very hard to look at. They were not yet finished in her studio, but I really didn't feel comfortable at all with the work, which of course is part of the effect. It was part of it, but she was very, very certain when talking about them that what she felt for them was love. And she wished them to be reclaimed for the territory of not only the acceptable, but the cherishable. She did not want them to be objects of freakish voyeurism in the museums. She was putting them in Hogarthian frames using the line of beauty.
And she also so put there them was into a kind this of op art yes, kind of surroundings. Yes. It was this very geometric. I don't know whether Louise is here, Louise Clark in the audience, who helped make these work and work with Helen on these pieces. But she also, but she didn't kind of make the nostalgic kind of freak show Wunderkammery things either. She very deliberately used a sort of 60s aesthetic, a sort of op art aesthetic, almost like targets.
But she also used the line of beauty she used. Because I remember it was the first time I'd actually heard it discussed. So I remember it.
Is it worth just, I mean, I'm just looking at the images on screen and thinking about what you're saying, Marina. And it strikes one that when an artist dies young, as Helen does, we tend to talk about their work as a unitary thing. You know, Helen's work was like this. But actually, when you think of the early work, which is sort of socially engaged, interventions outside the gallery context, performance-based, people on the dole about, overhearing people on London Transport. The journey in her work was pretty extreme. And what I don't know is, what were the external drivers of that journey? What was moving her through a very, very radical series of innovations in her own work? And it now strikes me as that something that I would love to be able to go back and see how that panned out. And Cathy, when you knew her, what was she working on then?
She was that year 95. So that was, I think she was beginning to work on that. So
how did she get from this, for example, to the Oval Court?
Bravery, I think. It's bravery. It's invention. It's like. She was the absolute example of an artist doing that. Yeah, it's an internal thing, but it's like, I think there's an internal thing, but it's like, it's about a mind clicking away and making those connections, isn't it? It's sort of, because how do you do that? How do you invent that?
She changed from this, which was what her surroundings were as she grew up and so forth, and she went on this trip to Bavaria, there she saw these absolute dream confections of buildings that were like cakes and were sort of covered in icing sugar
and pallets of it.
yes, and it spoke to her. She wanted to make something that would have that same sort of apparent frivolity, but would be highly wrought and would be sort of graceful and sort of frou-frou, but at the same time meaningful, significant.
But that was a very significant shift in the work then, wasn't it? Yes. And I think that's quite an unusual thing to happen to an artist, to have this moment of kind of epiphany or realisation, and almost overnight your whole approach changes, and that very, very radical shift. Mm. And it must have been a very brave thing to do. Mm.
Yeah, I mean, I think, but I mean, that I suppose is what artists do, and I suppose when you see the work, then it sometimes seems quite jumpy, doesn't it? But I guess there would be, speaking as an artist, is that there are periods of sort of despair and thinking and trying to work out what that next thing will be, and I think, what's extraordinary over such a short length of time, she's shown us. If we look at it, so many shifts in that thinking. And, to me, that, as you said, what would she be doing now? I mean, goodness me, it's mm-hmm. like, but within that mm-hmm. short space of time that she was creating, mm-hmm. how many changes of gear, which is, she'd made a lifetime's worth mm-hmm. in 20 years.
She was difficult to ask private questions. I mean, when I saw Vara Landscapes, I was a bit worried about her. I sort of felt, why was she having this sort of medical interest? I mean, she was a young woman. Mm. It seemed to me that
But AIDS HIV was running absolute riot at that point. It had just arrived. She was in Pembroke, wondering what she told me was she was in Pembroke, didn't know what to do in the countryside, totally urban artist. I mean, she loved nature, loved that, but within a sort of, you know, within a prescribed way. There was all this thundering beach and rocks and shorelines and all this. And I think she saw the permeability of the coastline and the fact that it's neither solid nor liquid, and made this kind of extraordinary leap into it being also the kind of permeability and vulnerability of the human form. And then, I mean, she went into the water with her paintings, and actually the paintings themselves got sloshed around with salt water to make the sort of the liquid forms, and then also scans of her own body with then cutting edge computer technology scanned on top. So you've got this incredible layering. So I think, you know, the medical thing, I mean, maybe she had some health issues as well, who knows, but certainly the whole AIDS thing was raging at that point.
Really, I mean, I did know her pretty well, but I felt I couldn't ask her. And similarly with the fertility material, when she was, I wondered about that too, but it was not, she was very private while being very exploratory and subjective, as you said. There was a deep, profound discretion.
She was quite formal, Helen, sometimes, wasn't she? I mean, she could be very earthy and we'd have filthy conversations, but it was within certain kind of parameters. As you say, there were certain kind of, you know, areas where you just didn't...
But don't you think that's the real mark of the extraordinariness of her work, that we don't really need her standing next to us to tell us what we should be thinking? You know, I think that was, like, also...
Well, great works of art one brings oneself
exactly,
to.
That the narrative and the literary content and, you know, the thinking in the work is open enough for us to enter. And, you know, we don't know so much about Helen. You know, that's almost the extraordinary thing.
But
we don't know so much about her. We don't know so much about Shakespeare.
I'm aware of the fact, though, that we are talking an awful lot about Helen, and there are an awful lot of people in the audience who did know Helen and would, I think, very much like to say some more things. So, Marjorie, I'll get you later. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
When I first came across Helen Chadwick, like 2 years ago, I was studying my master's, and one of my tutors told me, "Oh, did you see Helen Chadwick's work?" Like, "No, I don't know." And I saw it, and I absolutely love it. I just felt like, "Oh, wow, this is what I like," and I felt really like connection with what she does. And then I found out she passed away, and I thought, oh no, like, how can, I want to see what she will do right now. So I was wondering, because you say that she was really private, and I just wondering, like, how much she was putting off herself in the artwork. Like, do you think most of the artwork was self-portraiture, like where she was expressing herself, like her personality, or like even she was maybe talking about other things about femininity, do you think it was basically self-portraiture, like most of the work?
Yeah, I think probably a lot of it was. I think, you know, a lot of artists express themselves through art because they're not very good at expressing themselves in other means, and yes, I think she was an amazing example of an artist that was, in a sense, discussing herself, but left it open enough for us to enter, you know, if that makes sense, yeah.
And I think, as you say, most art is a form of self-portraiture, one way or another. I mean, not explicitly, but certainly in Helen's case, again, the subjectivity, but then pulling away and being, so in a way it was both senses of Helen. It was that kind of tremendous generosity and that sharing of information and sharing of reference, and indeed of one's own, her own viscera often, but at the same time, it wasn't autobiographical in that respect.
Well, she was trying to find different visual languages for different actual ways of thinking about the self. I mean, there are the brain is called self-portrait, I think. Mm-hmm. So she, you know, she actually wanted to shift the idea from the face, especially for women, from the face to the inside, to this, you know, this raw consciousness that she took this photograph of with her hands holding it, holding this brain. So there was a very deliberate desire to expand expand the iconographic language of the self. And it's very successful, I have to say.
And the meat abstracts, of course.
Constant invention in terms of these languages.
And the meat abstracts, where, you know, the lumps, I mean, it wasn't human meat, but, you know, it was meat that looks like all of us, with one with the light, the light of intellectual, the light of reason, and the one without. So you have the sense of the dichotomy. Marjorie, I'm aware that you wanted to have a word.
Well, when you mentioned the, you know, the contemporary horror of AIDS at that time, in Edge 90, which was a performance event in Madrid, which Rob Lefrene curated, I recall, because I was involved with that, with editing the catalogue with Steve, who subsequently died of AIDS after that. But Helen confronted reality. She was never somebody, although the work is quite discreet in certain respects, and she herself was not declamatory about her private, as Marina said, she confronted reality. And in Madrid, I think I'm correct in my, I didn't check before we came tonight, that I think she dyed the fountains in the town red in this particular place. So it was a direct reference to SARS at that time. And likewise with the Serpentine show, with the chocolate fountain, which I did write about, and because the scatological references in terms of chocolate, cacao in Italian means shit. And Cadbury's were the sponsors of that show. And they did not like the. In fact, they, as far as I recall, they wanted the catalogue shredded.
Wow!
Wow!
I think our dear director at the Serpentine was not to be bullied on that one. But it was that kind of confrontation with the viral landscapes of the reality of life, and so all the meat abstracts. And I remember going to see her once. And there was this small frame of a person sitting in the corner, literally sewing real lamb's tongues together. Mm. I mean, I couldn't do that. She didn't, you know, for her, the flesh, the body, everything was fair game. And she wasn't afraid.
We should tell the story of the roach. Of the cockroach. You tell it.
I'm actually wearing a cockroach around my neck. Oh, look! I mean, Helen really... I'm sorry, she is actually working this. So often we've talked about works and the relevant images come up. So anyway, yes, the cockroach. So the man comes to have a cockroach infestation at Beck Road.
Yes.
And the man comes to be the cockroach exterminator. And Helen goes off into a whole kind of psychosexual reverie fantasy about the cockroach man, and indeed the fact that, of course, cockroaches do look just like inverted cocks with that head on them and everything else. And she made a fantastic series. I mean, there's a cockroach as the kind of frontispiece in one of the catalogues, and she made a wonderful series of prints, which I'm also rather lucky to have one of, which was embossed the outline of the male form, but you could barely see. It was just on the sheet of paper, embossed the outline.
A Greek horos.
Thank you very much, Marina, for the proper reference. And then, of course, in the appropriate place is this beautiful cockroach, a la one that we've just been seeing. And it was so rude, but so beautiful, and so kind of, you know, typically Helen again, making the most banal, dreary thing of, you know, someone coming to fix up your vermin, into this kind of saucy, but also exquisite cockroach. So when I saw this in a souk in Morocco, I immediately, Helen was there guiding my hand to bargain it down. So yes, I mean, that fantastic ability to make everything so real, as you say, Marjorie. So God, I'm sure everyone, lots of people have got other fantastic Helen stories that they might want to. Yes.
So I would like to ask a question about Helen Chadwick as a feminist, and which groups or collectives she was working with, if she was part of any, or which theories or books she was referring to, how she became a feminist artist.
I'll take the
other female artist on the podium.
I think
there.
She was a female artist. Obviously, clearly, she was a feminist. I'm not aware that she was a group player. You know, like I think she had enough thoughts in her own head to not really need to belong to a collective. Or you know, I think when she did the earlier work, I think that was slightly more. I'm not quite sure, but I think that. To answer your question, she wasn't part of a group. I'm not aware of.
She was also, I mean, castigated by groups of feminists. Yeah, I mean, yeah. After Oval Court, I mean, she, you know, there was a lot of ill feeling. They gave her a very hard time. Mm. The groups, the sisterhood, the bands, because of all that Rococo frolicking and bad behaviour with.
I mean, there's an exchange in the Gina Newsom film. There's an exchange. It was filmed as a dinner party in honor of Judy Chicago. So it was a dinner party of women artists. And there's an exchange at one point when one of the artists, when Helen is defending her use of her own nudity in her work, and one of the other artists says to her, "But you're cute." So it was dodgy territory, but there actually is a very good, I think, intellectual study of her that comes from a very unusual angle about her relationship to architecture. It's by Stephen Walker, and that gives you quite a lot of the thinking, because he's the only person I think who's been through her entire archive. Yeah, who's been through her entire archives that are kept at the Henry Moore Institute up in Leeds. And he's been through every page of her journals and everything. And he's done a very fine piece of work. Mm. It's not so much about the organic side, and it's not about feminism, but it does give you the intellectual landscape she occupied.
He was meant to be here. Are you here, Stephen? Oh, look. Can we have a word from you about Helen and architecture?
It's just gone that way for somebody.
Sorry, is your mic? Is the mic doesn't seem to be. We're having a bit of. We have to get Helen to intervene with the mics as well.
I've got the one that works over here. That's why.
Ah. Okay. Well, in that case, we'll have you now, and then we'll.
And then I promise to give you the microphone.
Not going to let you escape now that I've waved your book around on the podium.
I wanted to say.
No, please go ahead.
Yeah, in response to the point about feminist collectives and things, just that I'm writing a 70s performance art UK-based study guide. And the 79 Hayward Annual, I understand that it's curated by various people, but one of the curators was Helen Chadwick, and she curated a lot of female performance artists who I'm visiting and having chats with about how happy they were that she programmed Sylvia Zirinek, various other people, into this program. So she was utterly dedicated to a feminine, even if she might not have been in a formal collective. That's all I'm going to say, except she did teach me. And in terms of legacy, she was a model teacher for how I teach now. Mm. Absolutely generous. So, yeah, that's it.
But that's fantastic. And also, you see, these kind of histories get buried, they get forgotten. So it's so important that you're saying that, because she was ironic about formal feminism of the 70s and early 80s, and their rather doctrinaire approach, didn't mean to say that she was in any way hostile to that aspect. So I think what you're saying is absolutely crucial. Sorry, I'll come back to you in one sec. Let's just have Stephen now. Sorry to put you on the spot here, but you know.
A red herring. I just wanted to come back to the idea that there's significant jumps within her realised output. I'm certainly reading through all of her journals and notebooks, and all the marginal notes that she kept within the library. There's a clear kind of enduring preoccupation. So, you know, from the earliest work, you know, there are ideas that she's chasing around that remain, you know, all the way through her working life. She also comes back to her notebook, so they're not kept in a linear way. She was clearly a voracious reader and would come back and either expand certain things. So, although the realised works change, there's a raft of ideas that she's, you know,
what
chasing.
Ideas particularly struck you? What, I mean, obviously multifarious, knowing,
yeah,
Helen, but does anything in particular that you thought,
well,
God, there's that
reflections
again?
Reflections on her own, or on the artist's role as, you know, having a creative persona, enduring interest in the philosophy of science and the, you know, the works of science. As you've been saying, this is kind of architectural installation work, the relationship between architecture and or artifice and nature. So a wide variety of kind of intellectual fuel that she then tries out. And I think when her realised work didn't, it sort of failed in her own terms, they were the moments when she would return to the ideas, but try and manifest them using different different kinds of art practice.
There was a great quote you put at the beginning of your book about Helen, that she wrote in one of her notebooks when she was pondering an essay. I'm going to horribly paraphrase here, but saying that she felt that theory was important, but as the OXO cube in the dinner, but actually it was the rich meats that were important for digestion and enjoyment. And I think that kind of idea that it's the art that has to be experienced, albeit with the ideas as a jumping off point, is absolutely crucial. Thank you for that. There's a lady over there who was keen to join in. But no, come, no, don't, wait for the microphone, says bossy Louisa on the podium.
I just wondered, because there are probably quite a lot of people in the audience who knew her well, but, as I was also taught by Helen, but I think that, peer artists, particularly women artists of her time, like Rose Garrard, or, there's a whole slew of them who she was very conscious of, and I think she was one voice amongst many. But if anyone here has a comment about her relationship with these other women artists, I saw her, in her, from her own spectrum, as somebody who did have a relationship with all these people. And my relationship with her was more as student to senior artists, let's say, but I think other people in the audience might know about those connections more.
Any thoughts on that? Any thoughts on Helen with her contemporaries? Certainly, I remember interviewing Rose Garrard at the time, and Rose speaking very favourably of Helen, and Helen of Rose. I mean, she wasn't uncollegiate, no. but I think she did plough very much her own furrow at the same time.
She was very driven, too.
Yes.
I mean, she made a lot of work.
Yes.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah. Absolutely.
I'd just like to say that Helen was actually a terrific neighbour.
Very important.
As you know, she lived in Beck Road. Lots of us lived in Beck Road. We're all pursuing our own art one way or another. And she was incredibly supportive, very friendly, always ready to share ideas, and had great humility, actually. And if she was a bit stuck, didn't hesitate to knock on the door for a cup of tea and discuss what she might be able to do. In my case, just, I want to do a bit of painting. Can you show me how to do this particular bit? So I don't know about her relationship with other feminist artists, but just as a friend and neighbour, she was really great to have around.
But that's so important to note, I think. Anybody else?
Sorry. Thank you. I was just thinking about her series Labours and the photographs and where she's already interacting with the sculptural pieces and what she's printed her body on. And I was thinking about the effect that the work had upon her, producing the work, and how that kind of might have adapted her and changed her. And I was wondering if you possibly knew if the work she produced kind of went on to affect her reasoning and thinking, I guess.
Well, certainly, I think physically, it didn't do her any good. The amount of labour, literally the labour that she made making her work, because she didn't have teams of, she had some assistants at the end. And I'm speaking literally, I know you're talking conceptually much more, but I just think, to be totally blunt about it, the chemicals she used, printing onto those surfaces for the ego geometria sum, I mean, Marjorie talked wonderfully about the sewing of the lamb's tongues. That's labour. But I think also a lot of the stuff, she was using stuff that was pretty toxic and pretty hardcore to use.
Her nails were ruined.
She had the ridged fingernails, didn't she? I remember a doctor, was talking about the fact that that did not bode well for toxicity. And just generally, I mean, one is still quite a mystery as to what actually did kill her. But the fact is that it certainly... You know, this didn't help. But conceptually, I think you're absolutely right as well. I think, you know, this actually using your body, actually the performative side that Marina was talking about. I mean, she was early performance, her work was performance based early on. I think, in a way, it continues being performative. The actual action of massing those blooms, of spooling the oil, one feels there's very much a kind of performative, physical, event based sensation to them. And the event of the piss flowers and the chocolate fountain, of course,
but,
as well.
But there is something about that work, Ego Geometrism, that's the closest that Helen got to an autobiography, isn't it? Mm. And I wonder whether that wasn't, therefore, an important moment in her career. And it's a sort of... Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm just trying to think what happened afterwards, but there was a sort of moving away from the more formal sculptural aspect of her work, perhaps. Mm.
The last piece in Ego Geometrism is the door of Beck
the
Road.
The door of Beck Road.
Yes, and she's entering, upright.
And she's, yes.
An adult.
Yes, yeah. Yeah. And she's entering the world of being an artist.
So it's from the incubator to the door, basically, isn't it? 30 years condensed into geometric. The pram, and I mean, it was as close as possible to the dimensions of these objects as well. But yes, I think you're right, that was a watershed, because it was autobiographical. But not at the same time.
Stephen Walker has this image at the beginning. I think we should ask of her as a trickster. You make a kind of theme out of the idea that she responded to the juggler card in the tarot.
Yeah, very much so. I think you've described her as well as an artificer. So there's in the double sense of this interest in making of the objects, but also the idea of the artificer as the trickster, you know, someone that's trying to not play fast and loose with the rules, but certainly being mindful of the rules and testing them out through the making. And if I guess for her, that was the role of the artist. So she very much identified with this one image in the tarot that she photocopies and writes about quite extensively, this idea of the juggler, and she identified herself as being like this juggler character, or certainly she identified her artistic self as being like the juggler.
Mm.
Mm. Mm. Like the magician.
But also I think her use of fabric, I mean, she did make her own work a lot, but she also used brilliant photographers, Edward Woodman being case in point. Brilliant fabrication when she could get it. Davy, I know, helped a lot with the actual technical work as well. And, you know, we forget now, because everybody and his dog goes off and gets their stuff outsourced and doing all that. But, you know, that was something that she was very good at when she knew she couldn't do it. Or, you know, it wasn't within her particular skill set. She got the best enamelers. She got the best casters to do the piss flowers. You know, the best kind of... So it was getting really good fabrication as well, in a way that, you know, people were quite snitty about it. And didn't she make it all herself?
She used small ads too, I remember, because she had an enormous delivery of mealyworms. And she used a fisherman's magazine, you know, to get these, and she showed me this sort of bucket of these, you know, creepy crawly things, which do appear in some of the work.
That was the normal way of getting stuff. That was the way of getting stuff. that was how it happened.
You didn't go to a fisherman's shop.
She did go a very, very long way. She made a tremendous effort to avoid anything the least bit conventional. I mean, there isn't a photograph that's just a photograph in her work, is there? Everything is a hybrid. Everything advances the technology. Everything pushes at the borders of what's possible. So,
but there also, as well, there seems to be this classical symbolic. I mean, she uses these really obvious graphic symbolic references. The geometrical thing that she wraps herself around.
Well, you've got the circle and a square.
The circle and the square. She uses these really, like, like very symbolic, heavy symbolic things, and then she sort of orchestrates them and puts them through a kind of filter. So she tries to signatureize them.
Well, you look
them
at the edge of that. That's, I mean, Swafiga and tomato juice.
I think the strange things. I mean, we talked about like her ambitions. I think Marina was talking about her ambitions and trying to imagine what her ambitions were, as opposed to reception. But I think, sort of sitting here and sort of looking at her work again, I actually think it is still really strong. Mm. It's still really powerful. And it sort of almost looks better now. I'm finding it better now than I did back then. But I don't know if that's just me. Mm. But well, it seems pretty current to me. Maybe that's we're supposed to be doing.
I think that's a kind of incredible note to end on, really. The fact that it does seem incredibly current, and we've got to keep it incredibly current and think of ways to keep this legacy going. I think it's a great shame that the Helen Chadwick Fellowship, the Arts Council Helen Chadwick Fellowship, which was between the Ruskin School and the British School of Rome, got cut, and some Arts Council cuts in 2011. But I think, you know, some kind of sense of, you know, hoping, trying, thinking about how we can keep this legacy going, maybe through residencies or through some kind of way to keep the flame alight. I mean, the fact that we're all sitting here and it's a packed out event is fantastic. So I think, you know, this is something that we need to keep that legacy going on. I am going to end up with a rather wonderful poem that Mark Haworth Booth, we mentioned him earlier on, he was such a key, or is, he's in Marrakesh unfortunately so he can't be here, but he was such a key figure. You know, he basically founded the whole photography section at the V&A, he acquired the Oval Court and was a huge champion of Helen's, and has written a really, I think, a very beautiful poem about her, so I'm going to try and do it justice by reading it as a kind of kiss-off. It's called A Hand of Feathers, and the subtitle is I.M. Helen Chadwick. So it's in memory of Helen Chadwick, but also I'm Helen Chadwick, and I am, so it's a nice bit of ambiguity. A feather floats across the station concourse, circles on impenetrable puffs of breeze, surfs and skis around Quick Snack kiosk, Thomas Cook and Knickerbox, planes and careens above the ticket machines, prowls around the world of flowers, drifts among the coats and cases, and the racing faces almost ceases to exist until it dances on a draft, rides a thermal from a burger joint, and rises to the roof beams. The blind designer of the quill, the shaft and vane, for robin, falcon and crane, engineers the tiny tools of barbs and their barbules, and knits the million slots and hooklets of each feather elastically together. What is as lucky as a feather, or as strong? Asks the artist Albert Chong. In The Voyage of the Beagle, Darwin writes of Calodria maculata, a bird which builds a vaulted passageway beside its nest, a kind of gallery of land shells, seashells, bones and feathers, chosen for the brilliance of their colours. This early form of installation art Charles Darwin called a space for playing in. In the rectory, an eagle's primary, found 40 years before on Rannoch Moor, soars above the mantelpiece, a shaft of highland sky, stooping to the study with hope for the microscope and grace for the Greek concordance. Cloud, darkness and dew, a lamp or phantom, lightning flash, spark or shooting star, the world's a bubble, a mirror, a dream, sings or hums the Diamond Cutter Sutra. Life's iridescent billowing balloon swoops without warning, unaccountably collapsing in a crowded lecture room, and every laughing spring day memory is trapped forever somewhere in the skull. Give me your hand again, show me your rings, shake the dagger on your left lapel, and tell me, darling, what to die in, before I plunge through the escalator. Pluck me a daisy, blow me a feather. Thank you, Mark, for that. So my thanks to the panel for their fantastic insights, and thank you all for coming, and let's keep the flame of Helen burning. Thank you.